Good morning and welcome to worship today. A special welcome to any friends, guests, or visitors we have with us. We are so glad to have you here. And we give thanks to God for continuing to gather us around the presence of Jesus Christ, even in these unusual times. We need each other and we need Jesus. So it is good to be with you this morning. One brief announcement before we begin. Today is the day of our annual meeting. Every year we gather to conduct the business of our church for the upcoming year while taking a look back at the previous year. We've shared this week an annual report that looks back on the previous year and presents a budget for the coming year and also has an agenda for today's meeting. Information about how to join that meeting was sent out by mail and email, so I hope if you're able, you will join us today at 11 o'clock for the annual meeting of our congregation. It is so good to be together with you this morning. Welcome to worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen.
See what you
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first lesson is from Deuteronomy chapter 18. Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord, your God, at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, 'If I hear the voice of the Lord, my God, anymore, or ever again see this great fire, I will die.' Then the Lord replied to me, 'They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded to the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.'" Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 111. Alleluia. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright in the congregation.
Great are your works, O Lord, pondered by all who delight in them.
Majesty and splendor mark your deeds, and your righteousness endures forever.
You cause your wonders to be remembered. You are gracious and full of compassion.
You give food to those who fear you, remembering forever your covenant.
You have shown your people the power of your works in giving them the lands of the nations.
The works of your hands are faithfulness and justice. All of your precepts are sure.
They stand fast forever and ever because they are done in truth and equity.
You sent redemption to your people and commanded your covenant forever. Holy and awesome is your name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice this have a good understanding. God's praises endures forever.
The second lesson is from the first book of Corinthians, chapter 8. Now, concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge. Since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their failing, I will never eat meat, so that I may not cause one of them to fall. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus and his disciples went to Capernaum. And when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Beloved of God, grace and peace to you from our heavenly parent, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I imagine that many of you know the story of Rumpelstiltskin. It's one of those German fairy tales that was collected and passed down by the Brothers Grimm. The story goes, an imp-like creature with magical powers helps a miller's daughter spin straw into gold. And in exchange, he asks for her firstborn child. But when the girl becomes queen and expects her first baby, she begs him not to take the child. He agrees, but only if she can guess his name in the next 3 days. 2 nights pass with no luck. She can't guess his name. But before the third night, the queen sneaks into the forest and hears the magical creature bragging that she will never guess that his name is Rumpelstiltskin. The next night, she names him, "Your name is Rumpelstiltskin." And in doing so, she is freed from her obligation to him, and she gets to keep her baby. Now, cultures around the world and throughout history have understood names
as having great power. There's even the sense that to name something is to have power over it. This is true of the cultures in the ancient Near East, where the stories and texts of our Bible first emerged. For example, in the story of Genesis, God invites the first human, Adam, to name the animals. The implication is that the one doing the naming has more authority than those being named, which, in this case, sets humanity apart as God's special partner within creation. Likewise, in the story of Moses at the burning bush, Moses asks for God's name. God says, "I am who I am," or "I will be who I will be." It's kind of a cagey answer when you think about it. I wonder if it carries the sense of, here's my name, but just because you have my name, that doesn't mean you can control me. And the name of God would come to be seen as so holy that observant Jews refused to speak it or even write it down out of respect and reverence. In other words, there is power in naming and in being named. In our gospel reading for today, Jesus is named by an unclean spirit, but Jesus rebukes the spirit, saying, "Be silent." Jesus begins his public ministry in Capernaum. Our story says that on the Sabbath, the holiest day of the week, Jesus enters the synagogue, the holiest place in the village. Now, just as a side note, the ruins of this ancient synagogue in Capernaum was one of the sites I visited on a pilgrimage a few years ago. So I am picturing this concrete location in this story, because we can be almost certain that this is one of the places where Jesus taught. The text notes that the people are amazed by Jesus because he teaches with authority. While he's teaching, a man with an unclean spirit begins to cry out. The narrator of the story seems to be begging us to ask a question here. What is a demon doing in a synagogue on the Sabbath? This is a holy place on a holy day. In some ways, it's the last place you would expect to encounter a possessed man with an unclean spirit. I remember as a child, I was quite creeped out and confused by these stories of demons and possessions in our Bible. And Hollywood doesn't help. Movies like The Exorcist and others like it can mess with our imaginations and can give us the wrong impression of what the Bible actually says. In reality, you won't find much support in the Bible for pop culture portrayals of possessions. I think as we mature, we come to realize that true evil is much more banal and insidious. I remember my parents teaching me not to worry so much about the monsters in the movies. They taught me instead to remember my baptism, to trace the sign of the cross on my forehead and say, "I am sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever." Because I belong to Jesus, and nothing and no one can change that. But there are several stories of demon possession and exorcism in the Gospels. The historian John Dominic Crossan notes that these stories are fairly unique to the time of Jesus. If you read the Hebrew Bible, our Old Testament, you won't find many instances of possession in the stories of Israel. It really only appears around the time of the first century. And why would that be? If our cosmology includes these supernatural unclean spirits, wouldn't you expect to see them throughout the history of God's people? Why just in this time period? Crossan postulates that it has to do with the possession of the land by a foreign military power. The land of the people of Israel was occupied by Rome. So perhaps these stories of possessions by unclean spirits were a spiritual way to talk about a political reality. Individuals were possessed by evil spirits in the same way that the land and institutions were possessed by a foreign empire. And there's also a possibility that possession was one way a pre-scientific culture could describe various mental illnesses, and we would have a much different way of understanding that now and better language for it. But with all of that in mind, I still believe these stories are important for us for confronting our reality. The language of demonic possession and exorcism can be helpful. It helps us to face some of the tougher stuff in our world. The simple truth is this: there are forces in our world that are not of God. There are forces that are, in fact, in opposition to the ways of Jesus Christ. What other language can we borrow, for example, for the gas chambers of Auschwitz, or the famine that's going on in Yemen, or any of the other horrors of history, let alone the personal tragedies in our communities? What other language can we use besides that of the demonic? There are forces in our world that are not of God and in opposition to the life-giving ways of Jesus. But I do want to distinguish here and distinguish this from demonizing a person or a group. Because if we read the scriptures, I think we'll find that the world doesn't easily fall into categories of good people and bad people, us and them. Rather, the line between good and evil cuts through each one of our hearts. That's what we confess today at the baptismal font. So we shouldn't be too quick to categorize the world into us and them, good and bad. Now, I believe part of what's going on in this story has to do with the power of naming and of being named. The unclean spirit cries out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebukes the spirit, saying, "Be silent." The spirit correctly names Jesus as the Holy One of God. And Jesus essentially says in reply, "Don't you dare name me. You do not have the authority to name me. You have no power over me." And Jesus casts the unclean spirit from the man. "Come out of him," Jesus says, and the unclean spirit has to obey. Jesus is the one with authority here. The commentator Osvaldo Venia says, "Unless we name the demons, they will name us." It's like the tale of Rumpelstiltskin. Once the queen knew his name, he no longer had power over her. She was free. Sometimes there are realities we are afraid or ashamed to name. I think of the characters in the Harry Potter books who are afraid to speak the name of the dark wizard Voldemort and instead refer to him as "he who must not be named." Only Harry Potter and a few of the other characters seem comfortable naming him. And it's the wise Albus Dumbledore who says, "Fear of a name increases fear of the thing itself." If we can't name it, we can't transform it. To name these hard realities is to open them up to God's transformation. If we can't diagnose the sickness, how can healing begin? Unless we name the demons, they will name us. In Mark's gospel, the unclean spirit appears in a holy place on a holy day, the last place you would expect. But we know this is true of our own holy places and holy days. We know that these ugly realities show up in our churches and in the history of the church. And we can't be afraid to name that. As it has been said, the church is a museum of saints, is not a museum of saints, but a hospital for sinners. This past week was International Holocaust Remembrance Day, a day when we remember the killing of 6 million Jews and 11 million others by the Nazi regime and its collaborators. One of the persistent demons haunting the Lutheran Church is anti-Semitism, and we can't be afraid to name that. Unless we name that demon, it will name us. Lutheranism began in Germany, after all, and the Holocaust took place in an area where Lutheran churches were strongly represented. The Nazis made use of Martin Luther's anti-Jewish writings to support their cause. And so our national denomination, the ELCA, made an official statement in 1994, rejecting and repudiating those writings by Luther, and pledging ourselves to oppose bigotry both within our church and in the society around us. I've been thinking about that pledge since January 6th. On that day, we saw some displaying hateful symbols of anti-Semitism and white supremacy. Perhaps you saw the picture of the man in the Camp Auschwitz shirt, and on the back it said staff. And this isn't to demonize just one person or even a group, but to recognize the ways that we are complicit, to recognize the ways we are caught up in a larger demonic force, a force that is against the ways of Jesus. Lutherans need to name that and resist that. We've pledged to name that and to resist that. Because unless we name that demon, it will name us. And so we boldly name the demons that have too often shown up in our churches. The demons of anti-Semitism, sexism, transphobia and homophobia, ableism, ageism, and white supremacy. Not to mention the classics of greed and pettiness and the like. And we name these things not because we're trying to be politically correct, not because we're trying to beat ourselves up, and not because we're trying to win points in some kind of woke Olympics. We name these things because we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And this Jesus we follow casts out demons. And the good news can overcome it. The good news is this: these demons have no authority over us. They have no right to name us. And on the other side of our fear, on the other side of our shame, is freedom and grace. It's just like the man in our story. Jesus set him free that day. The truth is this, my dear siblings. Only God can name you. You, after all, are a named and claimed child of God, set free for the sake of the world. Amen. Thank you. Today, we welcome three new members to our church family, Ann Wagaman, Patrick Nee, and Carolyn Schneider. These are three familiar faces. They have in common that they have each one of them been a part of the family already in so many ways. And yet, we haven't taken the time to formally welcome them in worship and to celebrate their presence among us. And we are so glad to do so today. So I hope in the comments and in other ways, we can find ways for you to welcome them to the church family too. So please help us welcome Anne, Patrick, and Carolyn.
Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for Patrick, Carolyn, and Anne, one with us in the body of Christ, whom we welcome as new members into the life and ministry of this congregation.
I, Mary Ober, present my spouse, Patrick Nee, for membership in our congregation.
I, Karen Paulson, present Carolyn Schneider for membership in our congregation.
I, Vicki Olson, present Ann Wegeman for membership in our congregation.
In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We are called to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Siblings in Christ, do you intend to continue in the covenant of your baptism among God's people in this place? And if so, I invite you to respond, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
Thank you. And people of God, those of you who are gathered here tonight on behalf of everyone at Trinity, do you promise to support and pray for these new members in their life in Christ?
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us welcome these siblings in Christ to this community of faith. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need.
For all who share the gospel and proclaim freedom in Christ throughout the world, prophets, teachers, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders, for the church and its ministries, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all God's works in creation, plants and animals, water and soil, forests and farms, and for those tasked with protecting our natural resources and all that exists, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For government and leaders, cities and nations, rescue professionals and legal aid attorneys, elected officials, and grassroots organizers for all responsible for the well-being of civil society. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
We give you thanks for our new members, Anne, Patrick, and Carolyn, whom you have drawn to yourself by the love of Jesus Christ, and whom we have welcomed into this household of faith. Keep us close together in your spirit, in the breaking of bread and the prayers, and in service to others. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, those who are sick and hospitalized, those living with HIV, AIDS, those struggling with mental illness, those who are hungry or homeless, and all in any need, especially David, Clem, Jane, Todd, Bill, Joyce, Maxine, Clarice, Myron, Debbie, Denia, Galen, Paul, David, Chris, Judy, Charlotte, Judy, Leshmi, Dennis, Chad, Larry, Mark, Sydney, Madeline, Darlene, Joan, Haley, Bob, Megan, and all whom we name now, aloud or silently. For caregivers, hospice workers, and home health aides, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the concerns of this congregation, those who travel, those absent from worship, those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, for the people of God in this place, and for other needs in our community, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the covenant God made with us in the waters of baptism, in thanksgiving for the baptized who have died in the Lord, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Take some time today to share a greeting of peace with your church family. Comment on Facebook or YouTube. Send a text, make a phone call. Find some way to reach out to one another today.
Peace of the Lord to all of you, my Trinity family. I love you all.
Peace be with you.
Meow.
Greetings from Mike and Roberta on Summers Avenue. We miss you all and hope you're staying warm and well.
Trinity members, we miss being with you. May God's peace be with you. Bless you. Jim and Linda.
For offering today, a thank you and a brief reminder. Thank you for your continuing support of Trinity Lutheran Church. We can do so much together to spread the gospel, to serve our neighbor, to support one another in Christian community. And so a brief reminder of the ways you can continue to give faithfully to Trinity. You can do so online at our website, tlcmsn.org, or you can mail in your offering to our mailing address, 1904 Winnebago Street. Thank you again and again for your generosity. We also have a musical offering today from Jim and Linda Svanoe. Thank you, Jim and Linda, for today's musical offering.
Alleluia. Praise all, praise to Christ.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, you revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name, and join their unending hymn. end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophets' hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us, bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Gathered together with your church family this morning, you are now invited to commune in your homes using the elements you have gathered. If you're with other people, share those elements with the words, "The body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you." And if not, receive these elements as a gift, and my voice as a voice from outside yourself, offering this gift to you in the name of Jesus. The body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. And if you are electing to fast, receive this blessing. Jesus loves you, forgives your sins. You are God's beloved child. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
Go in peace. Be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.